going to both councils. Go ahead.
On April 26th of 2013.
And the last one, and that was close.
May 29th, 2013.
Did you meet Justin Byers before you hired him?
No.
How did he come to get hired to work on your project?
He knew Justin and brought him on.
Well, did you delegate that to Keith? Say, go find somebody, or how is that arranged?
Yeah, as I mentioned, I said that this rate is going to take forever getting this house cleared out. So that was when you brought Justin
okay.
and somebody else.
And did Keith have a positive or negative reaction to the fact that he's going to have a lot of work?
Objection.
Did he have a reaction?
No.
Overruled.
Did you eventually meet Justin?
Yes.
How did you meet him?
He was at the job one day when I stopped by.
How often would you stop by at this particular job?
Once we owned it on a regular basis.
So, define regular basis.
Could be twice a day, could be twice in 3 days, depending on how many phone calls came my way about issues that came up, things that needed to be resolved, questions that needed to be answered.
Okay, so let's be specific. Let me ask you an additional question. At the time, we're talking May 2013, what other projects did you have in the vicinity?
In the vicinity, there was a project we were finishing up in Neptune, a commercial project in Neptune, had a factory there, and then I think we owned a place at the time in Oakhurst. We might have been fixing up a house in, we were renovating a house in Fairhaven to build a brand new house in Fairhaven.
So, did all of those projects require that you visit them on a fairly regular basis?
Yes.
And so would you try to visit them every day, or?
Yes, I could.
And with regard to 1602 Fourth Avenue, do you recall any specific issues that require your attention? Would you, as you say, you get a phone call and you have to come resolve something or see something or deal with something?
Yeah, initially, the carpenter started after we took title of the house. They had to rebuild the garage. Some of them I didn't know as well as others, but I wanted to have a say in the size of the rafters, how they were going to be cut, what was going to be supporting them, the power ties, how tall the walls would be, whether the foundation is still good underneath them.
And how many carpenters did you have working at that time?
I think three were back there.
Do you remember their names?
Mike Nelson, Jim Monaco, and what company? I don't want to say Neil, but it wasn't Neil. Glenn.
And was one of the three, say, more senior than the others? Or more in charge, sort of?
Yeah, it felt like Mike had a handle on what was going on. Jim was good, Glenn was more of a helper.
And when, if you remember, did you hire these guys?
That, I honestly don't remember. It was difficult to get people. Everybody was working down in the shore areas or further south.
Would it refresh your recollection with regards to Mike to look at a spreadsheet showing the checks that were issued on?
Yes.
This is S159.
date I wrote a check to Mike was May 24th.
Now, guys like Mike, what kind of payment arrangement did you have with them?
By the hour.
And when were the checks issued, weekly or?
Weekly, yes.
So this, would this have been an end of week check?
It would have been a check, but not Friday, whether the $600 for the check were hours attributed all to that job or to others. I can't really say, I can't remember what I was paying Mike.
So that would have been, the Friday would have been represented on May 24th, 23rd?
Yes, sir.
Did he work for you on any other projects at that time?
Yeah, everybody had sort of in a rotation depending on what I thought some guys did better than others. They would be deployed to different projects and do different things.
How did you come to hire them?
Yeah, put an ad on Craigslist.
Did you meet him in person?
I probably met Mike the first day on the job. Interviewed him on the phone.
And can you tell from looking at this when the last check was issued to him?
By 1602 4th Avenue LLC, that was on June 24th of 2013.
And the check for May 24th was also issued by 1602 4th Avenue?
Yes, yes.
So those would represent hours that you were attributing to that job?
Yes.
So after Justin was hired, after Mike and other partners were hired, what would you do when you stopped by on property?
I would check and see what kind of progress was made with the garage, with any of the other projects, once that was finished inside the house. What kind of progress had been made with getting the stuff out of the house.
So, flash forward to the week of May 24th. To that point, do you recall what type of progress had been made? Getting stuff out of the house? Say, in the month following Justin being hired, something like that.
Yeah, more progress had been made to that point. You could move through the whole house, including the basement.
All right, did you go to the basement?
Sure.
What did you see?
There was a lot more work to do. There was an old furnace in there that was going to have to be removed. There were things hanging from the floor joists, stuff packed in corners. There's an old pool table there, eventually, that was unearthed.
Anything else that you first noticed when you went down?
No.
What, anything about the condition of the floor?
No, I would have noticed. It was as I expected in a house that had effectively been abandoned for 10 or 15 years.
Now, post-closing, do you recall having any conversation with Lisa Linder about some items that she had left behind?
She said that she
had an objection. Hearsay was called for a yes or no.
Sorry.
No, let me roll the objection. The objection is the hearsay.
I think it simply documents a contact that he had. I asked if he had a conversation, so I wasn't asking for those specific contacts.
Okay, so the question was, are there any conversations about items that this lender has left behind, right?
Right, because this is half the time was passed from her to.
Yes, good question.
Yes.
Next question.
All right. As a result of that conversation or conversations, did you do anything? If you remember.
No, I don't remember.
As a result of those conversations, do you know if she did anything? become aware that a safe had been located on the property?
Yes.
Do you recall approximately when that was?
Sometime in early to mid-May.
After the closing or after title had passed?
Yes.
Do you recall how you found out about it?
I was standing up in the entrance to the dining room area and Keith walked up and said, I found a safe downstairs.
You say he walked up. What do you mean exactly? Walked up to you?
Walked up to me. Yeah, I don't know if he was downstairs or he came downstairs and walked through the kitchen entrance, but I was standing in the entrance to the dining room from the living room and he walked up and said, there's a safe in the basement. Not a safe in the basement.
So what did you do?
I said, all right, just leave it there and I'll have someone open it.
Did you go down and look at it?
If I didn't do it right then and there, it was over the next day or two that I went down. It was underneath the stairs, back way.
Do you remember what it looked like when you first saw it?
It was big. It was the size of one of those squares, the jurors box.
Yeah.
Squared off. It was big.
Was it built into a wall or a recess?
No, it was just underneath the landing to the stairs. Way back there.
Do you know if it was movable? Or could you tell that first time?
Not the first time. Not the first time.
Did you notice anything else about it? I mean, describe it as best you can. Was it new? Was it old?
No, it was clearly old. I think I might have shined a flashlight back there since it was underneath the landing to the steps. It was rusted. It had rounded corners.
Did it have a handle?
Not that I could tell.
Did it have any kind of combination knob?
Not that I could tell.
So how are you going to get it open?
I'm going to call somebody who knows how to open safes. Legally.
What, other than being old, what did you make any other observations of its overall condition?
It was rusted and scratched. Again, I didn't put my hands on it. I shined a light in there on it and sort of leaned over a lot of stuff that was still in front of it. And I could see how it was. No, I think just the top part of the front. Or if it wasn't the front, that it might have been spun, I don't know. But part of a side and the top.
And then, did you in fact arrange to have somebody come and open the safe?
No. Mike Nelson said to me.
Why did you go downstairs to see the safe?
I think they told me that they had opened up the safe downstairs.
Were you given information that caused you to go downstairs to check on the safe?
Yes, when I walked in, the carpenter said they were downstairs beating on the safe and they opened it up.
The carpenters being?
Mike and Jim, and if there was a third carpenter there, I don't remember.
And then you went down to confirm that? Or why did you go down?
Yeah, it was an event that happened on my job site and I wanted to go see what the story was with it.
Alright, so what did you see?
The side of the, side or top of the safe was totally beaten in and the metal was peeled back with the crowbar. And there were green payroll receipts on the floor of the basement and some inside the safe.
So you could see inside?
Oh, yes.
Any idea how many of these payroll receipts, well, let me ask you this, were they in checks? Or, you know?
I don't know.
Approximately what size were they?
I think they were bigger than regular check. Not that big. 3 by 7 or 8 feet.
What did the safe put his hands up in a rectangular box, maybe 6 inches?
Do you recall any writing on any of these items?
The Abrams Steel Company. Payroll to payroll company.
And there were a lot of these?
Yeah.
Did they appear to be canceled or negotiated?
I did look at them for that one.
Did anyone on the job, any of the workers hand you one of these?
I think Mike did.
Did you see anything else in the safe?
No, just more payroll receipts. Not all of them have been taken out of the safe.
And what did you learn about who had caused the hole to form inside the safe?
The carpenters told me they could hear the guys wailing on the safe for an hour and a half or so. And subsequently, because the buyers told me the method they used.
Yes. Double stripping.
All right. So.
So when I say stricken for the record, Judge, I'm saying you're stricken from memory as well. Go ahead. We get time for a break, Ms. Hunter?
I'm sorry?
Time to recess?
I don't think so.
Okay, I think this may be a good time to recess now. Give me a second, Dr. Thank you. Judges, what we'll do now is we're going to recess for the weekend, and we will continue the trial on Tuesday morning at 9 o'clock. Now, again, anytime there's a weekend, there's going to be time to reflect upon the case, but don't discuss the case with anyone. Don't conduct any research regarding this case. Again, I don't know whether there are going to be any accounts of the trial in the print media or any other medium. But if you should come across a story or a blog or something on the internet that you recognize pertains to this case, I am directing you to stop reading it immediately. Okay? And again, the reason why that's important is because your decision as judges in this case has to be made only on the basis of what is presented to you here in this courtroom by those lawyers. Admissible evidence that I deem to be admissible. Okay, that's the reason why that instruction is so important. Okay, we'll talk about the case, we'll research the case, and again, if anyone should attempt to communicate with you about anything pertaining to this matter, do not discuss it with anyone except me or a member of my court staff, and I will address them. Okay, so the usual protocol, 8:30 in the morning, look for my court staff, and then we'll just work it back up at 9 o'clock. Tuesday morning. All right, have a nice week. The jury has left the courtroom, anything to discuss before the recession will be. That's your.
I will certainly do that.
I issued the sequestration order. You should.